Where are my BCs at? My baptismal candidates. Awesome. So if you're getting baptized, come on in. I want to see all your smiling faces and your knobbly knees. No, just kidding. I always come out here when I'm going to be in the tank and come out in a pair of shorts and blind everybody with my white legs. I have an expression in Croatian when someone doesn't have a tan, they say that you're bijeli ko sir, which means white like cheese. I think I'm mozzarella. It's okay, all that tanning stuff is vanity anyway. Just stirring it up. Yeah. Praise the Lord. All right. We still got a few people changing, or we got everybody here? Mike, how many? Mike? Mike's changing. Praise the Lord. Because we're going to be talking all about baptism this morning. And just lest you think, oh, well, I've already been baptized. Hang in. You're going to get baptized again. Some people are like, what? No, once is enough. No, it's not. Okay, now that I have your attention, let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you, Lord God, for an amazing time of worship. Thank you for the worship team that you have blessed us with. Lord, that gift is your love manifested towards us. Thank you for this facility. Thank you for this sound system and knowledgeable hands and ears to run it. Lord, we thank you for your word. Thank you for the fellowship of believers. Thank you for freedom, for healing, for life. We sang about your goodness this morning. God, you are so good. You overwhelm us with your goodness. Lord, we thank you for your promise that you will never leave us nor forsake us. And thank you for your anointing upon your word as it comes through this instrument, this pipe. And I thank you, Lord God, that you make a sound that is a clear sound, Lord, that brings your sound into the hearts of people, not just sound into their ears, Lord God, but the truth of your word into hearts. And Lord, that seed would take root and produce fruit. Thank you, Father God, for your mercy. We're so privileged to be ones that you have chosen, that you have gifted with faith that we might believe. We ask that more gifts of faith would be given this morning. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Who was the first person or persons in the Bible to be baptized? Raise your hand if you think you know. Andy's actually following directions and raising his hand. Yes, Andy. Good try. Not quite. Anybody else? Raise your hand. No? John the Baptist. No, definitely. Well, they were drowned, but they weren't baptized. If you keep people under the water, that's not called baptism. That's called murder. So, but you're the closest of everybody. Yes, Noah. Someone, is that, okay, there you go. And you were probably raising your hand too. You get the toffee after church. Someone must have a toffee. Turn in your Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. And while you're turning, I'm going to start reading. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive in the spirit. After being made alive, he went and made proclamation to the imprisoned spirits, to those who were disobedient long ago when God waited patiently in the days of Noah while the ark was being built. Even the people who were disobedient, who died in the flood, still got preached to. That's what your Bible says. Because Noah wasn't disobedient. He was obedient. He built the ark, so it's not talking about him. So it says here, in it, in the ark, only a few people, eight in all, were saved through water. And this water symbolizes baptism that now saves you also. Not the removal of dirt from the body, but the pledge of a clear conscience toward God. It saves you by the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at God's right hand with angels, authorities, and powers in submission to him. In some of your Bibles, King James, New King James, it may say an antitype. And the definition of that is a person or thing in the Bible that is foreshadowed or represented by a type or symbol, especially a character or event in the New Testament prefigured in the Old Testament. So Noah was baptized. Noah and the seven other people with him went into the ark, and the ark was in the water. It says that the springs of the deep were loosed and poured forth. It says that the rain came down from heaven. Baptism is a symbol of being either immersed or surrounded by something, whether it be water. We'll see other places in Scripture where it references other things that you can be baptized by. But either way, it's an immersion in it, being completely surrounded by it. They had rain, probably rain that's never, ever been on the earth as much since, coming down from heaven. They had the springs of the deep. It says the ark was moving about. I'll bet it was moving about. The whole earth was being flooded. So Noah goes into the ark. The Lord puts him in the ark. And that which kills everyone else, because of Noah's obedience, he went through the same experience. He was there on the earth when the flood came, but he had a different outcome than those who did not obey, who did not repent. There was opportunity. He was building that ark for 100 years. There was opportunity for other people to go, I recognize that we're wicked. Can I come on board with you when this happens? But they mocked him, and they scoffed, and they laughed at him. But when the flood came, he passed through it. Many of you know Psalm 23 says, Yea, though I pass or walk through the valley of the shadow of death. We're going to see another baptism which has to do with a valley. Who entered into the next baptism in the Bible? That's right. 2 to 3 million people. Turn in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians 10. And starting in, well, let's just start in verse 1. Paul is writing to the Corinthians. He says, moreover, brethren or brothers, I would not, I'm just going to whip up here to you. I do not want you to be unaware that all our fathers were under the cloud. You remember it says that there was a cloud, a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. It was a pretty big cloud, obviously, because Scripture says they were under it. We think like maybe a little, you know, pole of cloud or something. What if it was a massive, humongous pillar that just went up above them straight up into heaven that could be seen for miles? Either way, it says that all our fathers were under the cloud, all passed through the sea. All were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. So we talk about the early church and we tend to think of the book of Acts. We think that's when the church came on the scene, but actually there's an earlier church. And it was these people, and these people were saved. Because they drank of Christ. Just as it says that Moses, this is going to mess with some of your theology, just as it says that Moses despised the riches of Egypt, preferring the reproach of Christ. Well, hang on a second. That's a couple thousand years before Christ came on the scene. That's right. But those who act in faith, in obedience to the spoken word of God, are acting in obedience to Christ because Christ is the revealed word of God. So when you obey the word of God, you're obeying Christ. And when you disobey the word of God, you're disobeying Christ. You're rejecting Christ. You're denying Christ. Sometimes we think the only way I can deny Christ is if, you know, someone runs into the church and says, okay, all you Christians up at the front. And we go, oh, actually, I'm not a Christian. Well, that would be denying Christ. No, denying Christ is when God comes to us repeatedly, day after day, and puts his finger on something in our lives. And we go, uh-uh. And we deny him. Whew, raises the stakes just a little. Verse 2, all were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. All ate the same spiritual food, the manna, which was the bread from heaven, which was again an antitype of Jesus who says, I am the bread from heaven. This is my body broken for you. Take, eat, do this in remembrance of me. It says, all drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. You understand that the entire nation of Israel came out from Egypt, was baptized, and took communion. Not only that, but they experienced sozo, which is salvation, deliverance, and healing. All of them were healed. There was not one sick when they left Egypt, or any poor, because they plundered Egypt. God gave them the whole shebang. He gave them the full meal deal. He gave them the full experience. Yet, let's keep reading. What does it say? Verse 5. But with most of them, God was not well pleased, for their bodies were scattered in the wilderness. Now these things became our examples to the intent that we, the Christians he's writing to, the Christians I'm speaking to, should not lust after evil things as they also lusted. Well, what's an evil thing? Anything that you put ahead of God. Could be video games. Could be food. Could be your hobby. Could be your job. Could be your wife and your kids. Anything that we put ahead of God becomes an evil thing because he said, seek first the kingdom. In his righteousness, and all the things that you need, food, clothing, and shelter, not big screen TVs and cars and all those kind of things. No, don't worry about what you will eat, drink, or put on. Food, clothing, and shelter will be added to you if you seek first his kingdom. This is what the word says. We are not allowed to even put the quest for our daily needs ahead of God's purposes in our lives. But that's not a standard that we hear often or that we necessarily see too many people evincing in our very comfortable North American church. And do not, verse 7, and do not become idolaters as were some of them, as it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. Nor let us commit sexual immorality as some of them did, and in one day 23,000 fell. Nor let us tempt Christ as some of them also tempted Christ, who didn't come on the earth for another 2,000 years. And some of them also tempted and were destroyed by serpents, nor complain. Let us not complain, as some of them also complained and were destroyed by the destroyer. He's speaking about people who were the church, who were saved, who were healed, who were delivered, who were prospered. And he acknowledges that they went through baptism. Wow. All these things happened to them as examples, and they were written, verse 11, for our admonition upon whom the ends of the ages have come. Therefore, verse 12, let him who thinks he stands take heed lest he fall. When Jesus came, he said, they are not all sons of Abraham. Actually, Paul said that. They are not all sons of Abraham who are the physical descendants of Abraham. They came out. We're the chosen people. God demolished Egypt. Look at us. We're chosen. Oh, here we are on the doors of the promised land. You want us to go in there? Cool. Let's see what it's like. Wow, look at the size of those grapes. Look at the size of those people. No. I think we should go back to Egypt. And God said, wrong choice. Now you stay in the desert for 40 years until you die. And their kids. Kids got to go in. We'll talk about that. Verse 13, no temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man, but God is faithful. He will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will also make the way of escape that you may be able to bear it. Don't you just hate it sometimes that God thinks that we can bear a whole lot more than we do? How many have been in a situation where you're like, are you serious? I cannot take this. I remember hugging the toilet one time after about 18 hours of throwing up and nausea and diarrhea going, God, it's enough. I was crying. I was literally crying. I'm like, whatever you wanted me to learn, I've learned it. I don't know what it was, but I've learned it, okay? You have to make it stop. And he didn't. It went on for a few more hours. Oh, that's right. You're God and I'm not. Okay. Thank you for finally making it stop. Baptism is a number of things. Baptism is obedience. Baptism is how we begin our faith. And if you are a Christian and you have not yet become baptized, I want to seriously challenge you and say, why not? John's baptism was a baptism of repentance. And Jesus, who had done no sin, came down and underwent John's baptism. And John's like, you should be baptizing me. And Jesus said what? Permit it to be so to fulfill all righteousness. In other words, if I, as the Lord and sinless one, am entering into this, none of my followers will have any excuse to refrain from baptism. Peter, in preaching in the book of Acts, says when, you know, Holy Spirit falls at Pentecost and, you know, all the people are speaking in tongues and all the Jews from the different nations come and they're like, we hear them declaring the wonderful works of God in our own language. What is this? And then Peter preaches his amazing message and 3,000 of them get saved, and they say, what must we do? And he says, repent and be baptized for the remission of sins. Repent and be baptized. Well, you don't have to actually be baptized in order to be saved. You really want to gamble on that? Like, honestly, why would you take the chance? Come on, there's water here. What doth hinder? What hinders? If you're here today and you haven't been baptized, and you get convicted by the end of this message that you need to be baptized, don't worry about your clothes. Come up here, we'll baptize you. Because you might get hit by a car when you get out on the street, and that might have been your last opportunity to obey the Lord. Seriously. People have passed away in this church recently. You do not know when your next day is going to be. Don't delay obeying the Lord now. Baptism is an act of obedience. Noah was obedient to build the ark. And then he went into the ark at God's command. And when the rains came down from above and the deep springs of the earth poured forth water from beneath, so that the ark, which was surrounded on all sides, above and beneath, with water, that which should have killed him and his family, did, as it did all the other then inhabitants of the world, did not kill them. And when somewhere between 364 and 370 days had passed, we won't keep you under for that long, they came forth to a new creation that had been purged of rebellion. Baptism is an act of faith, saying, shut up, flesh, you're not in charge. I'm giving my life to Jesus. I'm following him. Not just for a moment here in church on a Sunday morning with a whole bunch of people and an awesome worship band singing, down to the river, down to, that's what we're going to do. Okay, it's going to be awesome. It's going to be fun. Baptism is about your life. It's the first beginning. It's obedience, identification, declaration, and one more thing, it's prophecy. Baptism is prophecy. And we'll talk about why. The Israelites, in obedience to God, left Egypt, and the first miracle and rite of passage for the entire nation, 2 to 3 million of them, was passing through the Red Sea as God parted it to make a way for them, while the Egyptians were drowned. There is something coming upon the whole earth that is going to kill everybody. Everyone, Christians included, but we're going to come back to life. You know what it is? It's called death. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Can you imagine? Can you imagine the Israelites walking, and they say that the actual place, the sort of causeway in the Red Sea over which they walked, is only 600 feet deep compared to the rest of the portions of the Red Sea, which are over 1,500 feet deep or 2,000 feet deep. So there's this land bridge that's 600 feet down in the Red Sea at the place where they actually crossed over. They found it. They found the one beach is called the glass beach because all of the sand has been superheated and it's turned into almost like glass. Well, that's because remember the Bible says that God sent fire between the Israelites and the Egyptians to keep them at bay while he was, you know, busy parting the Red Sea. So he parts the Red Sea and they walk down and they're walking and they're looking up at 600 feet walls of water on either side. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. They went through that valley. And the Egyptians went, wow, this is kind of true. I can't think what their commander was thinking. Like, honestly, whoever's helping them, I think he's got more technology than we do. Just the amount of pride that they had to actually follow through. And then, of course, the Bible says that, you know, the sea came in and they were all drowned. We see that parallel again and again. That which baptizes the obedient kills the rebellious. Listen, that which baptizes the obedient kills the rebellious. When we go through things in our lives and we are obedient, it says, though you pass through the fire and the flood, you will not be drowned or burned. Not eternally. Physically, you might suffer pain. You might even die. But he promises that there will be a coming out again. It's almost like you could see people, you know, maybe, I don't know, some other nation standing on the side watching this transpire, and they're like, oh, the whole nation went into that roiling maelstrom of wind and water and everything like that. And they're like, oh. And then like, oh, but look, they're all coming out on the other side. How is that possible? Oh, look, the Egyptians have gone in. Oh, they didn't come out. We're supposed to go through things in our lives that would kill other people. You have a diagnosis of cancer. God says, only believe. You have a situation that's happening in your marriage, with your job, with your children, and you believe, and God says, trust me. Guys, there's many baptisms. But let's look at this. The whole nation, old families, teenagers, children, and babes went through the Red Sea and were under the cloud. But then they came to the doors of the promised land, and the adults went, mm-mm, no. And the Lord said, 40 years. 40 years of wandering in the wilderness, because you saw what I did to Egypt. You saw everything that I did, the hail, the lice, the frogs, the slaying of the firstborn. You saw what I did to the Egyptians. You saw me raise up the walls of water and I protected you. You've eaten the manna in the wilderness. You saw the quail that I brought. You heard the lightning. You heard the thunder. Saw the flashes of lightning as I gave forth the law. And yet you come to the promised land and you're concerned about the size of the people in there. Why don't you fear me? Wrong choice. Go back into the wilderness. And poor Joshua and Caleb, who were like, let's go, had to endure a 40-year sentence with the rest of them, but they died, and Joshua and Caleb, he kept strong. It's probably still pretty boring, though. You know what I'm saying? So they come again to the promised land. They're like, we're going to go in. All the kids are like, Mom and Dad, we're going in. And there was another baptism. It's called the crossing of the Jordan. Just for those who would like to preach infant baptism. No, you have to make a choice. As a person of accountability, understanding what you're doing. They went through the Red Sea, the children did. God says, no, now we're here at the Jordan. You choose. You step out in faith. Priests, go forward with the ark. God, it's in flood stage. You heard me. Don't make me ask you a second time. We're going. If we drown, we drown. But as soon as their feet hit the water, the Jordan stopped flowing. And they went and they stood in the middle of the Jordan. And Israel passed through the waters again and did that which was impossible from man's perspective and came out on the other side. There are many baptisms. It's not enough for your children that you have been baptized or that they were baptized as infants. Each one of us must, as we become of age, meaning able to understand sin and rebellion on a personal level and the consequences of it, and also able to understand faith toward God and the righteousness that comes by faith. When we reach that place, each of us must make a personal choice to obey him. Baptism is an act of obedience. Jesus said, "Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say?" It's the first and most crucial act of obedience that we take when we receive Christ. But it's not the only act of obedience, and it's not the only symbol of immersion. Jesus went to the Jordan, and he went in, and John baptized him, and from what we understand from previous scriptures, was not necessarily the cleanest river. Remember Naaman? He's like, "I ain't getting baptized in the muddy Jordan," or whatever. There's better rivers back home. So Jesus goes in and he's baptized, and when he comes out of the water, it says that the Holy Spirit descended upon him like a dove. And Jesus received the first Pentecost, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the anointing of the Holy Spirit. And then what happened? The Holy Spirit drove him into the wilderness. "Oh, I want the baptism of the Holy Spirit." Do you really? Look at the passage in Scripture. For those who are getting baptized here today, you need to understand something. You must do this because Jesus requires it. But you must understand that following Christ comes with testing and trial. He guarantees it. He promises it. And if you go into the water and then don't also seek the infilling of his Holy Spirit and the complete surrendering of your life to him, whatever ites you leave in the land, and some of you know what I'm talking about. Remember, Israel left some of the Amorites, the Perizzites, Girgashites, Subazites, little hums, ites. They left them in the land. Parasites, somebody. They left them in the land. And they became a thorn in their side. So if you take this step and you say, "I'm following you 100% Jesus," and you leave any area of known rebellion — we all have areas of unknown rebellion, just saying. We do, and you don't think you do, but you do, trust me. And if we leave any areas of known rebellion in our lives, those things will be a thorn in your side. The enemy will be able to use that to bring major attack against you. We take it very seriously. It's like, "Wow, I have to do this, but it's major. I'm going into the promised land, and now I got to fight. I'm crossing the Jordan. No more manna from heaven the way it was before. Now I have to work." And if anybody sold you that getting saved and coming in and becoming a Christian is going to mean that your life's going to get so much easier, in one sense, yes, and in another sense, no. There will be persecution from family, and we've seen it in this house with people who've gotten saved. There will be persecution on the job, persecution from friends. You're going to be like, "Oh, man, you go and get religion." No, I went and got relationship with my Creator, with the King of Kings. And it will cost you. Sooner or later, it will cost you. Baptism, after obedience, is an act of identification. What is baptism symbolic of? Symbolic of death. Baptism is symbolic of death. You go down in the water. And you know what? You don't dunk yourself. That's suicide. No, God baptizes you through those that he's chosen and brings around you, but it's him. You surrender to him. You lay back and you let someone else take you down into the water, and you let someone else bring you up. And it's symbolic of death. None of us chose to be born. Not one of us chose to be born. So then none of us should presume to think that we have the right to dictate the time or the manner of our departure from this earth, seeing as this body is not my body. Paul says, you are not your own. You were bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body, which is Christ's. He says, I have been crucified with Christ. I identify with his death and burial and resurrection. I have been crucified with Christ, and yet I live. Yet not I, but it is Christ who lives in me. And the life that I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God. I live by faith in the Son of God and by his faith. It's a symbol of death. Let's look at Mark chapter 10, verse 35. And here we got James and John, the sons of thunder, also known as the sons of Zebedee. That'd have been a good rap name back then, don't you think? Yo, what's your name, man? Zebedee. Is that like your real name or is that like a stage name? No, it's my real name. That's cool. Zebedee. What it be, brother? Verse 35. Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to him saying, Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask. That's a pretty loaded question, don't you think? Hey, I'm going to ask you something and you can't say no. Lord Jesus Christ, I'm going to ask you something and you have to give me whatever I ask. And Jesus just says, what do you want me to do for you? Verse 37, they said to him, grant us that we may sit one on your right hand and the other on your left in your glory. And we're asking you first, so we got dibs. Shotgun! All the rest of the disciples are back there. It says later on, it says when they found that out, they were all mad, right? But Jesus said to them, verse 38, you do not know what you ask. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink and be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? Yep. You don't even know what I'm about to go through. But they're like, we are able. So Jesus said to them, you will indeed drink the cup that I drink. I can see them after the cross, after Pentecost, remembering this and going, Jesus said we're going to be baptized with the same baptism. So they knew. They knew martyrdom was in their future. That's what he prophesied to them here, right? He says, you will indeed drink the cup that I drink, and with the baptisms I am baptized with, you will be baptized. But to sit on my right hand and on my left is not mine to give, but it is for those whom it is prepared. In other words, Father's going to make the choice on that one. In Luke 12, verse 49, Jesus is speaking and he says, I came to send fire on the earth, and how I wish it were already kindled, speaking of the Holy Spirit. In verse 50, but I have a baptism to be baptized with, and how distressed I am till it is accomplished. Wait a second. Jesus, you were already baptized at the Jordan. This is way later in your ministry. Are you saying that there's another baptism? Well, actually, he had two, because he had the baptism of water and the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And then there's another baptism coming. And do you remember what John said when he saw Jesus? He says, I baptize you with water, but there is one who is coming after me whose sandals I am not worthy to untie, and he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. That fire isn't just speaking about Pentecost, because he said he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. We all know what fire does. Fire refines. Fire purges. Fire burns up the dross. Fire kills. And fire hurts. I have a baptism to be baptized with, and how distressed I am till it is accomplished. Jesus knew what was coming. Even as Christ died, first to his own desires, his own agenda, his own prerogative, his own preferences, his own predilections. You know that word? Proclivities is another good word. Means what I want, my tendencies. Well, I have to have this kind of a coffee first thing in the morning. Really? What if God sends you somewhere and you can't get that? Can you still have joy? I mean, you might be there and be like, well, I'm here. Is everybody else around you going to pay because you're not getting your little pet thing met? Or can you still evince the character of Christ? Can you still demonstrate Jesus no matter what environment you're put in? Still be loving, still be patient, still be kind. Jesus died first to that. You know, Scripture says, it talks about Jesus, though he were a son, learning obedience through the things which he suffered, and having been perfected, is sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. And everybody, you know, when we say learned obedience through the things which he suffered, we tend to automatically think of the cross. And obviously, yes, that was a huge step of obedience, but he had to be the perfect sacrifice in order to be sacrificed. And so he had to be perfected along the way. And I'll tell you personally what I believe was one of the hardest things for Jesus to endure was the 18 years of waiting between 12 and 30 when he recognized who he was at 12 and ditched his parents. Come on. Stayed behind in Jerusalem. Mom and dad are gone. They find him after 3 days. We joke. It's one thing to lose your kid. It's another thing to lose the Messiah. Oh no, we lost the Messiah. We are so in trouble. And they find him. Son, what were you thinking? Didn't you know I must be about my Father's business? Scripture says, but they did not understand the saying which he said to them. Yeah, well, that's their problem. Really? Then why in the next verse does it say, then Jesus went with them and was subject to them in all things? Because deserting them without talking or telling them or asking anything was not being subject to his parents. But that's okay, because that wasn't sin. That was just youthful zeal. He woke up and went, I'm the Son of God. I got to get going here. And then the parents come back and I can see the Holy Spirit going, Jesus, you figured out who you are, but you haven't yet discerned the people that I've called you to lead. And they're going to have a hard enough time following a 30-year-old carpenter, never mind a 12-year-old boy. Wait. Wait. That's hard for me. You know, maybe outwardly I can fool you guys, but sometimes on the inside I think I'm spiritually ADHD. I'm just like, activity. I don't like waiting. If there's a line, a lot of traffic, I'll go just drive. And it'll take a longer way to get there, and it probably, if I'd have waited in traffic, I would be there faster. But I just like the sense of movement. But that's not a good thing. It's not a good thing. It's a lack of trust on my part. It's a lack of trust in God. It's, I want movement for the sake of movement because it makes me feel good. Oh, so it's about your feelings, is it, Mike? Sometimes. But I'm trying to die to that. Baptism is an act of identification with Jesus being God, emptying himself of his godhood, coming down here, taking the very nature of a servant. Joseph in the Bible is not mentioned again after that incident in Jerusalem. We hear no mention of Joseph whatsoever. Many scholars believe that Joseph at some point died because passages in the Old Testament which prophesy the Messiah say things like, behold, I took up the plight or the cause of the widow and the orphan. So most likely something happened to Joseph and Jesus had to become the head of the home. So put your ministry on hold, put it on the shelf, and stay in the home and be the man of the house and support your mom and help take care of your brothers and sisters. And you can see him, 16 years of age. It's like, oh, now God, come on, Josiah was 8 when he became king. You know, he's just like, he knows the scripture, right? He's 18, 20, 21. You know, in America, which won't be here for a couple thousand years, actually more like, 2,000 years or so, they could even drink by 20. No, 21. I'm 21. Can I already start my ministry? God's like, nope, wait. 22, 25. His friends are getting married. Wait. I'm the Son of God. Wait. How many people have to run ahead into their ministry? It's not because they love God so much. It's because they love themselves. And they want the freedom of doing their own thing. Finally, 30 comes, and he's so used to waiting, he almost misses it. You know, his mom comes to him at the wedding, and she's like, there's no more wine. He's like, Mom, it's not my time. It's like almost like a, just a thing he says. It's not my time. I know, Dad, it's not my time. It's not my time. His mom's like, do whatever he tells you. And he's like, Father, look, what? It's my time? This miracle, this one, for the first? Are you serious? You know, we could get in trouble with this later on. Okay, all right. Waiting is hard, but Jesus submitted. Jesus submitted to the baptism of his will, to the baptism of humbling himself, of taking himself off the throne, what I think is best. What does it say over and over and over again in the Old Testament describing the Israelites? And each man did what was right in his own eyes, which was, from God's perspective, completely wrong. And Jesus comes, and he's got, I don't know, some kind of, you'd think he'd have some sort of claim to having a pretty decent perspective. But the Lord said, wait, and he waited. And then when he did begin his ministry, he said, I do not testify of myself. I do not speak concerning myself, but I only do the will and the works of him who sent me. I'm not here, even though I'm God in the flesh, I'm not here to do anything of my own initiation. I'm here just to do what I see the Father do, to say what I hear him say. And sometimes that will be to forgive the woman caught in adultery and do the absolute opposite of what everybody thinks I should do. And at other times that will be to rebuke even my own disciples and say things like, Peter, get behind me, Satan. To feed 5,000 people and they're all like, this is so amazing. And then to turn around and tell them the only reason you're coming after me is because you want more bread. And by the way, if you really want bread, my body is bread. My flesh is bread, and you have to eat me, and you have to drink my blood. It's the worst thing you could say to a Jew. Cannibalism was like 11 on the list of things you don't do. Scale of 1 to 10. You know why he said that? Because God was saying that. You know why he did that? Because God was doing that. He put God first. He exalted God's will above his own. Baptism is third, an act of declaration. It is a public statement to all present, including, of course, people, but also powers and principalities, angels, demons, and the great cloud of witnesses, and to those who may hear of it afterwards. And what is it a declaration of? I have decided to follow Jesus. And follow Jesus where? Many are willing to follow him into the Jordan. The first baptism. Because that's like a one-off. It's like a one-time thing. It's a celebration, especially if other people are doing it. We need to do it, regardless of whether everybody's cheering us on or railing against us. We need to do it. We are so blessed in this country because when we baptize people, everybody cheers. You go into the Middle East and you get baptized over there, and they're waiting for you with knives when you come out of the water. Either way, we must obey. But where are we to follow Jesus? Jesus was baptized by John in the Jordan River at the beginning of his ministry, and then coming out of the water, he was baptized in the Holy Spirit. But then Jesus was led into the wilderness, fasting for 40 days and nights and being tested by the Lord and tempted by the devil. And then Christ spent 3 years doing not his own works, but the works of him who had sent him. And ultimately then, Christ went to the cross and stated that if anyone was not willing to take up his own cross and follow Christ, he was not worthy to be his disciple. He said that. If anyone will not take up his cross and follow me, he is not worthy to be my disciple. Many Christians think that following Christ means to follow him into the Jordan, but we must also follow him to Golgotha. We must follow him to the place of crucifixion. And this is a beautiful and poignant and powerful symbol that we do, but it is also prophecy. Listen, the reason that this is so important that we understand this is because when we get into this water, we are prophesying into the Spirit, and we are saying, I will follow Jesus into death. And by submitting to baptism, I'm obeying him now, and I will continue to obey him in the future. I will obey him in this act, and then I will obey him when he leads me into the wilderness. When he says, What does God say to the children of Israel? He says, behold, I brought you forth from Egypt, and I took you into the wilderness, and I caused you to hunger, and then I fed you with bread from heaven. I tested you to know whether or to know what was in your heart and whether you would obey me or not. I promise you that every single person who gets baptized, and for all of us here who have been baptized, if you haven't been tested already, it's because you haven't followed God into the wilderness when the Holy Spirit tried to take you there. He will purify all of us, and it comes through obedience. It comes through following him. The blood of Jesus, listen, the blood of Jesus cleanses us from our past evil actions. But there is another provision that has been made for our present evil desires. You can't plead the blood of Jesus over your desires. There's one thing that sanctifies your desires, and it's the word of truth. As the word says, sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. We are sanctified by the truth on an ongoing basis. So maybe I got baptized, 20-some years ago, I went down into the tub. But if that's all I did, then I wouldn't be here today. Scripture speaks of the washing of the water of the word. Let's look at that scripture. That's in Ephesians 5:25 says, husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word, that he might present her to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. Do you remember when Jesus was speaking to his disciples and he says, I am the vine, you are the branches, if any man abide in me. Well, here, let's just read it. He bears fruit, verse 2. Every branch, John 15, verse 1-4. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away, meaning the Father. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes. Why? That it may bear more fruit. I know, but it hurts. You are already clean. Why? Because of the word which I have spoken to you. The word baptizes us. And I need baptizing daily. I need a fresh baptism of the word. The word of God washes me clean. It's not enough to go in this tank on a one-time basis. You have to go in the tank as a prophecy that you will live your life in the word of God and be continually washed by the word. It's not a religious duty. It's a prophecy of what we're entering into. And what we're saying is, I'm going to enter into your kingdom, to your light, to your cleansing power through your word, through obedience, and then I will experience a steady stream of the word of God flowing through me. If you're trying to live your Christian life without being continually baptized in the word of God, which means what? Baptism is immersed in the word of God. Then all you have is an outward religiosity. You have a form of godliness that denies the power, which may be evidenced by the fact that maybe nobody in your particular oikos is getting saved because of you. If you've got unsaved friends who are on their way to hell and you really love them, but you feel like you lack the power in order to bring them to Jesus, it's not because power is lacking. Power is available. Oil is available. It's in the word of God. What has happened is we have ceased to be transformed because you know what we do? We get peckish when it comes to the word. We go fill up on the things of this world, and then we come to the word for a snack afterwards, like a little bit of cheese or grapes or something after the main course, and we take a little bit. That's not going to change us. We have to get hungry for God's word, and we have to immerse ourselves in it. Baptism is an act of prophecy. We are prophesying that we will be both faithful and surrendered unto death. The dying to ourselves, to our old carnal sin nature, to our independence, and finally, even to the manner and time of our natural death. But that we do so trusting, submitting, and surrendering to God, and that he who has promised is faithful and will raise us up on the last day. When you go down in that water today, baptismal candidates, I want you to think about heaven. I want you to think about that great baptism which is coming for all flesh, which is called death. Every single one of us is going to die. But do you have faith right now? Because you're living that faith out right now, whether you've been saved 5 minutes or 50 years. Do you have faith right now that Christ will raise you up because you are in him and in his word? A few years ago, our senior pastor's wife, Ken was senior pastor at that time, and Char suddenly came forward and said, the Holy Spirit is speaking to me and saying, I need to get rebaptized. And you were baptized at what, 15 or something? When you were 12. So she was baptized when she was 12 or so. But the Holy Spirit brought back to her, and it's almost like a husbands and wives renew their vows. You know, she's in pretty good company, because I remember Charlie Robinson, many of you would know of Charlie Robinson. Charlie Robinson was in this church as an elder for many years, is now an itinerant evangelist and preacher who goes all over the world. And the Lord spoke to him as well and said, I want you to get baptized again. I want you to renew your vows to me. I want you to return to your first love. I want a refreshing. Whether you feel to do that or not, we all need to get back in the Word and let the Word wash us clean and let the Word baptize us. Because you know what? We get dirty from living in this world. Jesus had been speaking to his disciples, and then they came to the house after they'd been doing the ministry, 3 years of ministry, and it was at the Last Supper, and Jesus knelt down and began to wash their feet. And Peter said, no, you can't wash my feet. And get this, Jesus said, if I don't wash your feet, you can have no part of me. And then he said, well, then wash all of me. And he says, no, he who has had a bath is already clean and only needs his feet washed. Guys, you get, that's so not freeing, you know? It's like if I say I don't want you, then you're like, well, then you can't have any. And I'm like, okay, well, then do it all. No, I'm just going to do what I want to do because I'm God. And I'm like that. And I expect you to obey. And Peter submitted to it. And the rest of the disciples submitted to it. Because when you're living in this world and you're going about your life in this world, your walk can get dirty. You know what I mean? Your walk can get dirty. It's not that you become a wicked person, but the things of this world get on you and you need to cleanse yourself. And how do you do that? Through the Word. Through the Word. Through the Word. Through the Word. Get in the Word. All of you who are getting baptized, get in the Word, stay in the Word, stay in the Word, get in the Word, and then get in the Word some more, and then stay in the Word, and then get in the Word again. Get in the Word. Get in the Word. Don't delude yourself into thinking you're a Christian if you're not reading the Word. You must read the Word. You must live in the Word. The Word will wash you, cleanse you. It will deal with your past evil. No, it'll deal with your present desires that are contrary to what God wants for you. The blood of Jesus, I don't care if you were a mass murderer, the moment you repent, the moment you cry out to him, he takes all of your sin and throws it in the sea of forgetfulness. But you might still have some cling-ons. You might have some attitudes, some habits. You know, you can cast out a demon. You can't cast out a habit. You have to break it. And how are you going to break your habits? Get in the Word. And stay in the Word. And what happens is the more you read the Word, it transforms the way you think. And suddenly you stop believing lies and you start believing the truth. And then when you know the truth, it makes you free.
Oh, wonderful. So if you're here today and you want to give your life to Jesus Christ, and you want to get baptized, I invite you to just come up here and sit beside any of these people, or stand beside any of these people on the stage. Hallelujah. All right, Mr. Clark, come on in, buddy.
They were millions of years old. How could they be? How could this just happen 6,000 to 7,000 years ago? So I started reading in the Word and going to Bible study. So I believed that Jesus was my Savior, but I still had all these questions. And then I went and seen a movie called War Room. And that changed my whole life. I felt the Holy Spirit come over my life, and I had no more questions. I just wanted to get more involved with the community and the church, and then I all of a sudden, everything just started changing in my life. It just, I had no worries. I was, had no voids in my life. I wasn't searching for anything. It was already here for me. So now I'm just getting so involved in the Word, and I just in the Word, and I just love life now. And I just feel so at peace.
Yeah!
Only God can set it up like that. Because I didn't know when we were going to do the baptism, but the Holy Spirit did.
Praise God.
All right, so once you fold your hands across your chest and you know, you need to plug your nose, whatever. So, but before you do, I'm going to ask you a question and I want you to be like, yes. Okay, so. Clark, have you given your heart, soul, spirit, and body to Jesus Christ?
Yes, I have.
Have you received him as your Lord and Savior, both now and forever?
Yes, I have.
All right, on the confession of your faith, we baptize you now in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Woo! Woo!
Jesus, please do so now. And I sat in my chair and I gave my heart and accepted Jesus as Lord.
Well, we would like to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Your nose.
Yeah.
I was saved 20 years ago, and I decided to take the devil's handcuffs instead of the gift of Christ. So 2 years ago, in obedience, I got rid of my playlist on my phone, and I only listened to Christian music. And I begged God. I said, show me your love. And that's what he did. And he loves me. He loves you so much. He loves you so much. And the time for being lukewarm is over.
Come on!
He's the fire. He represents Jesus Christ. Praise God.
You sure? Have you rededicated yourself back
absolutely,
to Jesus?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay. Let's get baptized.
Let's get baptized.
So we baptize you, Cheryl, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
So I was basically living on the streets, and God really took care of me because I had nowhere to go. I stayed at my dad's, I stayed at my friend's house, and then I stayed somewhere else, just can't remember. And then I ended up staying at Dean's house next door, and I was there for 2 months, so big thank you to Dean.
Thank you, Dean.
And then I stayed with Connor for about a week, and Now I'm living at the Joshua House, and just wanted to give a shout out to Cody Richard. Cody Richard, Tia Story, and Braden, they're the ones who got me saved, who served us peace. They're the ones who got me saved last year, and just thankful for them. And just really happy, you know? Drug abuse, and I'm clean, and finally free from that, and God set me free from that. Thank you.
Alright, then just one second, I'm going to ask you a question, and then you can plug your nose afterwards. So, Jeremy, have you given your heart to Jesus Christ?
Yes, I have.
Have you purposed to follow him all the days of your life?
Yes, I have.
All right, on the confession of your faith, we baptize you now in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Lord, we thank you, Lord God, for the word of the Lord that Pastor Mike talked about, is washing, the washing of the water of the word of God. Lord, they're wet in the natural, but get them wet in the spirit.
Yes.
So that, Lord God, that they'll be immersed and baptized in the word of God. Father, your word says that your grace is sufficient. Everybody say that. Your grace is sufficient. And so, Lord God, we bless you for they're part of the family of Almighty God. In Jesus' name, everybody said,
amen. Yeah.
So there are those that want prayer, that have never given your heart to Jesus Christ, and you have some questions, just like one of our brothers had said, and you want to come here to the front, we've got prayer altar ministry that would love to be able to pray with you. Any needs you have, but you know what, we want to introduce you to our best friend. His name is Jesus Christ. So if you want to rededicate your life to the Lord, if you've never been saved, if you want to give your heart to Christ, then come on up here to the front. We'd love to pray with you. Those that want to congratulate the people on the front, come on up here to the front as well. Congratulations. God bless you. You're dismissed. Have a Holy Ghost week. The mission school is out there for you.